Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins, you used to live in sin just like the rest of the world, obeying the devil, the commander of the powers in the unseen world. He is the spirit at work in the hearts of those who refuse to obey God. All of us used to live that way, following the passionate desires and inclinations of our sinful nature. By our very nature, we were subject to God's anger, just like everyone else. But God is so rich in mercy, and he loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, he gave us life when he raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved. For he raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ Jesus. So God can point to us in all future ages as examples of the incredible wealth of his grace and kindness towards us, as shown in all he has done for us who are united with Christ Jesus. God saved you by his grace when you believed, and you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the good things he planned for us long ago.
Can you believe Paul said that? You are God's masterpiece? So who do you think you are? Last week I asked that same question, who do you think you are? And we talked last week about you being an ambassador. And we didn't go into it all what ambassadors do, but basically, as God's ambassador, your role is to bring words from heaven to earth. And what ambassadors do, if you're an ambassador of the United States to another country, you bring the words from the administration in Washington to that government there. Well, if we're God's ambassador, and God's in heaven, then our role is to bring the word of heaven to earth. We are an ambassador to the people around us. That's what we're about. How are you doing? Doing a good job? Awful quiet. If you think you have problems as an ambassador, if you think you have problems as a disciple, you have problems because we come from a problem. Look at the scripture. Once you were dead because of your disobedience and your many sins. Now that you always remember, I think Paul pretty well tells us this. Anytime you think the finger is pointing at you, remember those three pointing back at the corner, because that's about the way the balance is. What he's saying is that without Christ, there's something wrong with us, with you, with me, with all of us. Once you were dead. And by that very nature, by the human nature that became with us when Adam and Eve fell in the garden, that made us subject to God's anger. So that's what happened to us. We're sinners. And as such, by our own strength, by our own imagination, we are not able to represent God. We aren't able. We can't. Because we're stained. We're not good enough. I got to thinking this week about some of the applications of this. And I got to thinking, what's your opinion of a half-truth? Has anybody ever told a half-truth? I was changing jobs one time, and my boss wanted to know, why are you leaving us? And I said, there's a better opportunity, something I like to do. That was true, absolutely true. But the reason I went looking for it is I didn't like where I was. But I didn't say that, you know, don't burn a bridge if you don't have to. That's a half-truth, though, isn't it? Does that make it a lie? Let you decide on that. What I'm getting at is, have you ever been told, or have you ever told someone, you are a sinner? Well, that's a half-truth. You are a sinner, just like me. That's the whole truth. You are a sinner, just like me. Now, what you're doing, if it's a sinful attitude, I may never have sinned that way, but it's only because I haven't had the opportunity, or I didn't particularly, wasn't in that situation. But there have been others. I'm a sinner too. So that's the message that Paul has got. We're all sinners. And the question is of being an ambassador and of being a masterpiece is what we are about, is to make the family of God, the kingdom of God, to be real and attractive to the people who are not part of it. And we don't get them interested by accusing them, just like Harold Campbell hasn't done a whole lot for the family of God in this, well, this particular end of time. It's at least his second prediction of a date, and he miscalculated then, and I'm not sure he's an asset to the kingdom of God anyway, except that his radio network plays pretty music. So, the question, always remember that. If you accuse somebody of being a sinner, just like me, I'm not sinning. I am going toward perfection. I am trying to become perfect. But I'm a sinner too. But you can get into this walk of trying to become perfect. That's the way we sell the kingdom of Christ. We'll not do it on our own. But can you imagine that with Christ, when you accept Christ, you become God's masterpiece? That's what Paul is telling the people in Ephesus here. You are God's masterpiece. You like that? The title, you ever been told that before? I've come close. I don't know how many times I've been told, Martin, you are a piece of work. Now, I'm not sure. I'm not sure it was a smile they were wearing, like Paul was wearing. Their lips went up, but I think it was a grimace. But something tells me that a piece of work is not a masterpiece. Just remember that as God's masterpiece, you are created for a purpose. The fullness, the beauty in you, it has a purpose. The psalmist wrote in Psalm 139, he's talking to God. You made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so wonderfully complex. The other translation's phrase that you would remember from that is, I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Thank you for making me that way. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. You watched me as I was being formed in utter seclusion, as I was woven together in the dark of the womb. You saw me before I was born. Every day of my life was recorded in your book. Every moment was laid out before a single day had passed. God wrote the book, made the plans, but they can be changed. We can change them. If they aren't following God's plan, we're the ones that have changed it. There are things to do. God brings an opportunity, and I can't do it. I'm not trained to do it. People won't listen to me. I'm not interested in it. I don't have the ability or the talent. Peter answered that question in his second letter. He said, by his divine power, God has given us everything we need for living a godly life. We have received all of this by coming to know him, the one who called us to himself by means of his marvelous glory and excellence. God will give us the means. You got something in your life that you think will keep you from serving God, from being a masterpiece, from being seen as a masterpiece? We all do, if we're honest with ourselves. I have a saying for that. Can't remember Bill's last name. He was in our Emmaus family. A career sailor and a real sailor. Had the big arms. Bill Brewer. Big arms with dancing girls on his forearms. Tattooed. But twitching his muscles, he can make them dance. And I'm sure he had examples when he had it put on there. And he says, what can I do? And I come up with that saying, Bill, just remember, nobody is good for nothing. You can always be used as a bad example. God can use us if we give ourselves as a bad example. I did that, but I don't want to do it anymore. I did it wrong, but I didn't know God then. All of that was forgiven when I accepted Christ. So you always have that. And you're never without use or purpose. Remember, Paul wrote in his epistle to the Romans. Everybody remembers Romans 8, 28, and we know that God causes everything not to be good, but to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. He takes the bad and mixes it in, and he makes it come out for his purpose. And when it's for his purpose, it's good. That's what we're all about as his masterpiece. God told Jeremiah to go visit the potter. Go down the street to where the potter is working. Jeremiah said, so I did as he told me. And I found the potter working at his wheel. You know, the potter sits there. Back in the days, well, they still do it. If you ever go watch people do this, they have the foot pedals and the wheel goes around and you got this lump of clay they work on. Jeremiah said the potter was working at his wheel, but the jar he was making did not turn out as he hoped. So he crushed it into a lump of clay again and started over. If you've not seen it, just imagine it, trying to make a jar, and that either a bubble comes up in a place where it's going to not work, not be a good jar, or it's going to be weak. So the potter crushes it all down. Doesn't throw it out. Starts over again. Make sure the water, the mixture is right, and starts again, and builds something else. That's what God can do to us. But with us, we have to yield. We have to let God be the potter. There's nothing in us that God can't remake. There's nothing that is so bad. And there's nothing that's so good that he can't refine it and improve it. I'm going to close with this example, and I want you to think about it. There was an art collector. He had a great collection of arts, and he had a sitting room where he had much of his art displayed. Well, he bought a big picture. Don't know if it was a portrait. Some stories tell it was a portrait of Jesus. But, you know, imagine whatever picture you would like to have as the centerpiece of your sitting room. He bought this big picture. He said, I'll put that over my mantelpiece. Well, he took it into his sitting room and had his helpers come in and they hung it over the mantelpiece. It didn't look right. Something didn't look just right. So he took it down from there, cleaned off the other wall, moved it over there, over the couch. Didn't look right. I said, well, I guess I'll get a decorator to come in here, tell me what to do. Decorator come in, looked at the picture, looked at the room, and his first instruction was, empty the room. Do what? Take everything out. Take all the pictures off the wall, take all the furniture out. So they did. Patched all the holes in the wall, painted it, made the room look like he wanted. Brought the main picture in and hung it over the mantel. Looked great. Then he said, now, fix the room up the way you want it. The centerpiece has to be there first. That's the way our life is with Christ. We do not work Christ into our lives. That's what the message is in that story. We don't work Christ into our lives. We build our lives around Christ. That's the story of being the masterpiece. We look to God's masterpiece, Jesus of Nazareth, God with skin and bones. We look to him as our ideal, and we become like him. But he has to come in first, and then we build our life around him. We have to empty our life to let Christ in, and then we work everything else around that. Think about that. That's the gospel message. And that's our surrender that allows that to happen. Live that way. Amen.